goes to camps who risk their lives to save other Jews. Just recently, I was very moved by a blog in the Washington Post by Menachem Rosenstein, in which he told the story of his mother. He told of the loss of her parents, her husband, and a small son. And yet she found constant and countless ways to save lives. She and many other Jews in Bergen-Belsen stole food, smuggled medicine, and nurtured the young children who had survived with songs, but more important, with hope. Adasha Rosenstaff and her other women friends helped save 149 children through that very difficult winter and spring of 1945. By the way, I think it's worth noting that in Mrs. Rosenstaff's memoirs, she tried to speak for all those who had been liberated in Bergen-Belsen. When she said, quote, "For the greater part of the liberated Jews of Bergen-Belsen, there was no ecstasy, no joy after liberation. We had lost our families, our homes, we had no place to go. Nobody to hug, nobody was waiting for us anywhere. We had been liberated from death and from the fear of death, but we were not free from the fear of life. You never know what people are going to do when faced with crises, but they did go on. They went on to build societies. They went on to build and make an enormous contribution to the United States of America. I cannot tell you again how honored I am to be here this evening to help celebrate the Holocaust Museum's 20th anniversary. I would like to say this, and I can't say this strongly enough. This museum is more than a museum for the remembrance of the horrors of the Holocaust. It is a monument to the indomitable human spirit. Thank you.
Moments. Some are glorious, others not. Some are late, others are not. One thing is, in life, the moments define our being, define our ideas, define the direction of our soul. It's the moment I fell in love, the moment I got desperate, the moment, every moment, one moment and another, at the end of one's life, is the sum of the moments that define it well. This is such a meaning. Some of us have invested quite a lot of our energy, the imagination, the fervor in remembrance, which is incorporated in the museum's ideas. And tonight, of course, is one of those glorious moments to have your ear in the thousands, young and old. Parents and children, and then parents and grandchildren, and simply to be together, to be together and remember together an era that is filled with darkness, but also with moments of pride, an era in which the young and the old were dormant. The young because of their future, and the old because of their past. We know how it happened. This museum, especially in its tens of thousands of documents and books, tell you how it happened. But we don't know why. We thought, why? I am not far to ask. Usually, in the Jewish tradition, we believe that God is a God of justice, and therefore something bad happens to that person because that person has committed a sin, My God, what kind of sins have my grandparents, my ancestors, could commit to warrant such a punishment? I don't know. I checked all the sources, interrogated many of my teachers all day. I couldn't find an answer. I don't have an answer. But I do know, if there is an answer, then hope must be part of it. Now, of course, it's not easy. You go into this museum and you see what men have done to other men. But systems have done to fail in their mission. What cultured people could do in the name of their culture and at the same time condemn and empower people to extinction and men and women to prison and to torture. So how can one believe? How can one believe even for a religious person in God's mercy and power? And all this people? How can one believe in history, in the sense of history, when we have seen almost the end of history, which I felt when I entered Auschwitz, the evening when my father and I were walking in the shadow of flames. God, my dream was, this is the end of history. So how can one believe? The teachers here, the parents are teachers, and I am a teacher. What can we tell our children, our students, to believe in what? There are so many reasons to say, okay, forget it. But that's not an answer. To forget that event would be an accusation of ourselves. To forget that event in all of its ramifications would be an admission of defeat. So we must remember that this museum of God is a museum of remembrance. It hurts so much, let it hurt. We shed tears, we have enough tears. To be in pain, we have pain. But how else can we go on living unless we face that path in all of its sincerity and form? So therefore, when you listen to the witnesses, and when you read all these documents in the Gospels, what do we learn? First of all, we learn that our contribution to everything is possible. Second, we learn that the human condition is such that we are capable of the best and the worst. But the choice is ours. So the choice is ours. And therefore, those who committed the crimes had a choice not to commit them. But this is their education, or was it something? Pressure, some other pressure, but they had a choice and nevertheless committed those crimes. Or punishment, I don't even know what kind of punishment exists for such people. Maybe their punishment is our memory. As long as we remember, the criminals, those who committed those crimes, are punished. But how long can we go? How can we live like that? I remember for years people think, in the 50s, how can we tell this story? It's so sad. Why drive students and young people to despair? But on the other hand, how can we not tell this story? Sometimes I write in order to explain why I cannot write about that part. But I write. So what therefore have I learned? Oh, very simply, I come from a very different background. What I learned in my youth is feeling me even today. And my parents were just not that part of Hasidim. Very religious. And here I am, there is a secret in my memories, in my experiences. The buyer arrived to say to them, "You are no longer here. You were wrong." But then my father-in-law would give up any options early because there was one pair of the humane of nectaries smuggled into the camp. And simply, it took 2 seconds just to bear the feeling, say the blessing, the Father of God. Why did he do that? That was not the place. There are certain laws in Judaism that one must observe even at the risk of paying it in one's life. That's not one of them. So why did he do that? After the war, I came to France. And strangely enough, my first intuition and decision was the Jose Bonvillier, a very religious home, because I was still religious, and I threw myself into more religiosity. As if I wanted to say to the master of the universe, Lord, New Testament, maybe you wanted me to lose you and to deny you, I don't. In spite of your unbelief, is that an answer? Surely it's a question. It is so easy to give up. It is so easy to give in, but we cannot. What would the world gain if we, the witnesses, the survivors, would say, pick it up? But the world is not worthy of our chaos. We never chose that option. That's why we have a monumental amount of testimonies. And this is what makes this meeting so great, the personal testimonies. And each testimony is testimony not to despair. The reasons for despair are dead. Up to the way that despair was overcome, which means even in the middle of extraordinary suffering and death, it is given to the human being to maintain his or her humanity. It is given to every one of us to say, look, we have the right to give up on civilization. We have seen what civilization has produced. I do not use that right. We have the right to.